thing you raised was on oil prices and how we're going to maintain this level of growth. And of course, you did hit upon the point, which is that ultimately all train companies, and I suspect all transport operators, are a bit at the mercy of the macroeconomics, if you like, of the region that they operate in. So if the economy of Liverpool is doing well, and the GDP and the GDA is doing well, then generally our demand will be going up. And that's why we put a lot of effort into making sure that we contribute to the health of the region economy. We know it's good for our passenger carrying to the long run. But oil prices do worry us, because oil, petrol is so cheap now that I guess there are people who will be very tempted to stop using the train and just fill their car up and jump in the car. And of course, I've noticed since moving to Liverpool that the highways network here is pretty well developed. I know people complain about it, but you know, there's quite a lot of motorways and there aren't huge queues. There's traffic hotspots as there are in every city. So it's kind of quite easy for people to make a choice between using the train, using the bus, or jumping in the car, especially if they own a car. So that does worry me. But I think there are lots more things we can do to drive growth. On Boxing Day, I tried to park in Lime Street car park, but it was shut, because of course Lime Street was shut. So I parked in Liverpool One for the day. I think I was in there for 11 hours, and it cost me £13. And that's the first time I've parked. That's the first time I brought my car to Liverpool, to be honest with you, because I use the train to get everywhere. But that's the first time I've parked in Liverpool and realised how expensive it was. So there's more stuff we can be doing to highlight the fact that although our fares have just gone up, as somebody else mentioned earlier, the fares that we have here are really good value, especially when you take car parking in the centre of town into account. And there's stuff we should be doing as well with, say, large employers. We should have a very active marketing strategy. Merseytravel, I know, could help us here because they've got good networks, whereby we're going to say to large employers, give us a list of your staff who live near stations and who could make their journey to work by train. And we could do proactive things like offering them a first-year discount, say, on a season ticket to entice them onto the railway. Those are all sort of things we can do within the company to counteract any threats to growth that might come from cheaper oil prices and other economic factors.
Rob?
Yeah, I'm going to have a however. What's my thought?
created a what was an entirely 100% a rail journey, a pedestrian journey, into a pedestrian plus car journey plus rail journey. So we need to be clever about the way we design future car park expansions. If we're generating new journeys, people that didn't use the train before, absolutely 100% the right thing to do. But we just need to be careful about the sort of abstractive effect of people jumping in their car to Birkenhead North rather than getting on the train at Watson Village or New Brighton, wherever they live. I'd much prefer them to use the train for the entire time.
Well, I think if you pass the survey, you would probably find it to be beautiful for its impact.
It's a mix.
Okay, thanks for that, Jan. I've just been summing up. I think that was really useful, so thank you for the presentation. It's great to hear how closely you're working with Liz and the team with regards to smart ticketing. Believe you me, we're as impatient as you are to make kind of further progress with what we've already achieved in the past 12 months on Walgreens. Really well done on Boxing Day. You know, I don't think we should unsell the fact that, aside from Chilton, we were the only network in the country that was running a proper service, and it's great to hear that's been successful, and we really look forward to working with you over the next 12 months to get right for this coming Boxing Day. And really thank you for the fact that the plans that you and your team pulled together were quite sort of short notice almost. You did that in a few months. What we'll be able to do over the next year and beyond, I think stands us in really good stead. Overall, it's great as well that you've got a vision, not just to kind of continue the great standards that we've had from Merseyrail over the past 12 years, but thinking about what the next 12 years will be. What we don't want, and we know you don't want, is a great railway by early 2000 standards. What we want is a great railway by 2020-2030 standards. But the key points that you actually kind of underlined is that, yes, the aspirations for a world-class railway, but the way we achieve that is by working very, very closely together. And I can assure you, everyone from this organisation wants to continue that really strong, close working relationship that we've always had with Merseyrail and take that to the next level. So thanks ever so much for coming along today. We look forward to welcoming you back at a point in the future to chart the progress further. But if I can just ask everyone just to put their hands together to thank you. Okay, if we want to move on then, item number five is the Mersey Ferries long-term strategy. Now, Gary Evans is going to present this for us, but before I invite Gary to do that, I just wanted to make a couple of key points, because obviously this item has generated a lot of interest. That's really important that it does, because it demonstrates not just how important the ferries are to this organisation, but most importantly, how important ferries are to the whole Liverpool City region. I just want to underline the point as well that today's report will not see any decisions made on any potential changes that may or may not happen at a point in time in the future with regard to the ferries. But just to reassure people as well, at the end of the report, myself and Councillor Fouch will be moving a motion, which we hope will reassure people about the certainty of the terminals going forward. So I'll let Gary present the report. We'll then have some contributions from the floor, and then we'll move that recommendation. So Gary, over to you.
Thank you, Chair. The purpose of the report is to share the outcomes from the recently commissioned Mersey Ferries long-term strategy and seek endorsements of that 20-year strategy moving forward for Mersey Ferries operations. The strategy was intended to build on the excellent work already undertaken by members and officers in reducing the operating deficits of Mersey Ferries, and to look at a longer-term operations to allow a clear vision and decision-making framework over the next 20 years. And in section 3.2 of the report, that chart helps to just demonstrate how operating subsidy has been reduced, particularly over the last 3 to 4 years. In section 3.3, however, we identify that while the operating subsidy has reduced, the capital expenditure year-on-year averages in the region of £2.5 million as well. And there's very a limited strategy around how that capital investment is made. So, for example, the vessels are over 50 years of age and still require significant investment in terms of upkeep and maintenance year on year. So the strategy was commissioned and delivered by external consultants, Mott McDonald, supported by a range of various marine specialists, Peter Brett Associates and Graham and Woolnose, with the objectives as outlined in section 3.5 of the report. which in effect was to A, reduce the, reflect the customer demand on the Mersey Ferries, B, provide a level of service that our customers aspire to, but also ensure that it looks to be as cost neutral as possible to the public purse, C, to ensure, as you said, to be sustainable in every way, from an environmental, economic and social perspective, but most importantly, the right and D is to ensure that the ferries are there for future generations to enjoy moving forward. It's about recognising the investment that's going to be made over the next 20 years and to target that investment around that economic framework. Attached to the report is an executive summary of that strategy. The latter pages as such tease out some of the proposals and potential actions and decisions that the organisation can take in reducing the operating deficit. And really, upon endorsement of the strategy, it's about officers going away, exploring those in more detail and bringing each of those decisions back before this committee moving forward to reach those decisions. Happy to take any questions.
Yeah, thanks for that, Harry. Any questions or comments, Steve and Ken?
Something based on, but I think there has to be some criticism, I think, from the elected members in terms of the release of the report and the focus of attention on the negativity of it. I would like to just turn it completely on its head and say that if I was a leader of a council or running a council service and anybody was talking in terms in this day and age where the government that we have is actually savaging public services across the sector, it's almost waging war on the public sector. If there was once, if I had a service and someone was coming forward with a paper that was offering me 20-year lifespan and beyond, I would grab that with both hands initially. I would say that is undoubtedly positive news for the ferry service of this city region, an iconic ferry service that we as an organisation are planning for the next 20, 25 years. So we have to take that as a very, very positive aspect. And there are some very good initiatives within the report that would allow us to do that, and particularly a way forward of getting new vessels, which is key, obviously, if we can bring Toby Asian. And vessels that will actually allow us to generate more income and make it even more sustainable. So the way it is sustainability. But obviously, everyone's eyes have been drawn to the one paragraph that doesn't make good reading. But these are people who, in a professional capacity, have been asked to do a helicopter view of the service and give us their deliberations. And this is what, to me, is why I became a politician and why we joined these organisations, is to actually have an influence on behalf of the people we represent in using these facts, figures and information to actually develop the strategy. And this is a good starting point for the strategy, but that's what it is, as you say, Chair. It's a discussion document for us to move forward. Now, I welcome the interest that's been generated by this report, and there are some good ideas coming from the public and from groups who are at the moment to call themselves protest groups. There's absolutely no reason why those protest groups can't become a useful ally and tool and actually develop the strategy as we go on. So for me, it is a document that maybe could have been handled in terms of PR issues a lot better, but nevertheless it does give people some reassurance that this organisation cherishes the ferry service, or with all the economic problems it presents and the challenges it presents, we cherish that service and want to maintain it for 20-25 years. I think there's a way forward that we can think about. Certainly it highlights the purchase of the vessels, the older models and purchase of the vessels. I would just ask just to consider the same sort of logic and strategy we've used for building up the reserves for the rolling stock and the project management that we've gone through that all members seem to have appreciated. Could, the figures are still high by anyone's measure. We are talking in 20s of millions of pounds in this document. But we can handle that in a similar way as we have to build up reserves for the rolling stock, i.e. building up a reserve for capital, having some separate, ways of generating money. The other thing I would say though, Chair, that shouldn't stop us while this long-term strategy is being debated, still thinking of ideas to actually make the ferry service more efficient and operationally more successful. And there are things that are coming
keeping the boat on the river overnight with a full crew doesn't seem a good use of public money. So there are lots of things we can do as we build up this strategy. But my overall view is that, apart from the one negative paragraph, it's a positive way forward for the longevity of the multicultural ferry service. And we'll hope to reassure the public when you move your resolution here. Thank you.
Steve, Ken, and then Jerry.
Thanks, Chairman. Thanks for that presentation today. I, as Steve said, I think this really should be welcome to everybody in Merseyside, because where else in the country do we see a 20-year strategy to keep in place the very Mersey Ferries beyond all the treasure? I mean, members a few weeks ago were over the water, were invited over to Cavill there to see Royal Irish of the Mersey being refitted. There's a huge expenditure on here. I wasn't allowed down into the dock because I was on crutches at the time, but those members that went down had a good view of that. I was speaking to Eugene, the foreman, on about the things that were happening, and possibly on things I shouldn't have been speaking about, on forward plans. But the thing is, you know, we're looking possibly at renewing the fleet, renewing the vessels. You know, where else in the country the people about talking about renewing vessels to keep that these things on the river? I mean, I find this a positive report, and I recommend the report, Cheryl. Thank you.
Thanks, Ken. Jerry?
Decisions been taken at this stage. One of what the strategy has teased out is a challenge that really the drive is to reduce costs and get into a cost neutral position. And you would look at, because of the investment plan in the two Willow based terminals in the next number of years, is to bring one of those into question. That's not a decision that is in any way really taken on this basis. And what it would look, and the rationale around that, if you look at patronage levels, current patronage levels, those terminals. The Woodside terminal is used the least of the other three. To give an indication of that, approximately 65% of the patronage comes to the pier head, approximately 25% through Sicker, and approximately 10% through Woodside. If members will recall, the decision previously taken was about withdrawing the commuter service from Woodside, a difficult decision to make, but one that was based on the footfall of that's reality of what we face. So the demand is there. What we've recognised within this strategy is 20 years is an awful long time. We need to absolutely review that through the life of the strategy, and we need to take into account the regeneration factors, things like water waters, where if demand returns, we can happily replace that or react to that in our strategy moving forward. I don't envisage a short-term closure of any table. What needs to be considered in some detail moving forward, and if the decision is taken to operate from the three terminals, then again, we've got a decision-making framework that we've made over the 20-year period. It should be continually reviewed based on footfall. So we do recognise there's attractions in each. So for example, one of the big draws in Pierhead is Liverpool City Centre. A big draw of Seacombe is the regeneration of New Brighton. same happens at Birkenhead, then they're fantastic. Current demand doesn't reflect that. And I think as well as the transport service from there, the other cross-river opportunities for the nearby Hamilton Square railway station and so on give people choices, and unfortunately that is impacting on patronage levels.
Frank,
thanks
very much.
Please, Chair. I think three questions or comments that have been made so far are really important, and I think it is a positive development, it is a positive approach. Unfortunately, there has been some negative media and PR around. I'd just like to direct members to page 17 of the report, the executive summary in relation to the strategy. And if you look at that first paragraph there, it defines what we're trying to do with this. It is about producing a strategy with the aim of providing a long-term programme for the investment in Mersey Ferries to make sure that we can maximise the benefits that they bring to the local economy. Similarly, if you look to the next paragraph down, what we're asking there, or looking to deliver there in the final sentence, is a strategy that aims to ensure that the ferries continue to fulfil these roles. We just need to make sure we do that in the most cost-effective way from a public purse perspective. As Liam touched on at the start, as Gary has reiterated, this isn't about requesting approval for individual decisions, this is about requesting approval for the principle of utilising a strategic approach to the future development of Mersey Ferries, but that future development is meant to be a positive development, not a negative one.
Gordon, and then Ron, and then Steve, to come back.
No. Suggest that you move your resolution, it might help debate for them.
Right. Go on, Ron, do you want to say
anything? I think while I welcome what Gary said, it's, at the end of the day, the report has been commissioned, and this report gives us a number of options, but that's what they are, options. And quite clearly, Stretch pointed out, there's no decision to be made on the option there. They're awaiting further information that will come forward as the programme strategy is in progress. What I would just like to think and say, I know Jerry touched on it, but he didn't, it's more localised what Jerry was saying, but the tourism offer has to be encompassed in what the combined authority tourist offer is. So it's not just in isolation of what Wirral is and the two ferry terminals on Wirral. It's about the whole offer for the Merseyside region, and that the Mersey Ferry is integral part of that Merseyside region, not belonging to Wirral. Have to be started in 1300. It doesn't belong to Wirral. It belongs to the people of Merseyside and the Merseyside region, the Mersey Ferries. And that's why they call them Mersey Ferries, not Woodside Ferry or the Seacombe Ferry. They call them Mersey Ferries as a package. I think that's what to be mindful of. And it's about how we maintain their future in the long term. We're talking about 20 years. I'm talking about the next 200 years. We want to keep them here forever. As long as we've got a river, we're going to need some way of getting across the river. We can't keep building tunnels, we can't keep building bridges, we have to use other formats. And it's how do we maximise their benefits to the benefits of all. And that's the problem we're facing, because we're facing severe cuts from the central government, and we have to make savings, and that's part of the process of making savings. But also, how do we balance the benefits for the wider region as opposed to a cost element? And that's what has to be factored in, and that's what the future work will be doing. I know there's some decisions being made. I think the problem is part of the ethos is that it's coming out that we are, because of low footfall, low this and low that, and low numbers, we're not given much options. It seems to me that's the option we have to do. It's closed one, but it's not. That's not the option. It's one of the suggestions, but it's not an option. The option will come in the future when the strategy is actually firmed up. I think we're probably, some of the things that the hairs are running now, and some of the comments, and I'm not disrespectful of the officer, but comments the officer made, only highlights their hairs again. And we have to put a temper on things and say, the decision was made by politicians with recommendations from officers, and then let's see what the recommendations are in the future, before I make my mind up on what I will say on the future. So these are part of the option process that goes forward.
Go on, Gordon, I'll let you make your contribution and I'll just
wondered if you wanted to
encapsulated all, but I'll take the opportunity to now. I really sort of endorse all the points that have been made by members from the floor now, because actually this organisation cherishes those ferries just as much as all the citizens of our city region and much beyond it. And actually one of our greatest privileges as members of this organisation is actually it's our role to be guardians, to be custodians of those ferries. And actually it's all about how we do safeguard them for the long term. Because Ron's right, it's not just about the next 20 years, it's for generations to come. Yeah, they've always been cherished by those that went before us, and hopefully for many, many generations to come, that will be the case. But obviously in safeguarding them, we can't take a do-nothing approach, we need to take a strategic approach. Actually, what is the basis of how we maximise the ferries? Because they're a vital asset for our city region. You know, one of the kind of statistics that someone's regaled to me, and you can take these things with a pinch of salt, but that for every pound that is spent on the ferries, another £7 is spent in the local tourist economy. That really showed how important they are to our local economy, not just our local way of life. So whilst, of course, we've got to be cost-effective in how you run any organisation, public or private, you've got to be cost-effective. And not least, picking up on the points that Steve's just made, with the backdrop of the kind of horrendous situation we find ourselves in the public sector because of the government of the day, we've got to be cost-effective. The key thing to focus on in this strategy is practical and achievable visionary growth. How do we maximise the ferries? And what I really like about what we've put together in this strategy is some of the really positive stuff that's in there. Yeah, procuring new vessels, a true, not just invest to save, but invest to grow. Now we can make sure we've got sort of vessels which really do take us into the future. Focusing on the charter market, there's great opportunities of more we can do on the river, but the kind of events that are coming to this city region and will only grow in the future. How we can do more to market them better for commuters, how we can get more tourists on them in the peak seasons. There's lots and lots of very sort of visionary approaches in this strategy. I think it's really important as well that we work very closely with all those stakeholder groups who love the ferries as much as I do and as we do. And I'm really looking forward to, in the next few weeks, when I sit down with my good friend Frank Field and his group, looking at some of the ideas that they're bringing to the table around Woodside. Fantastic, innovative approaches that hopefully we can work together on and see what we can devise accordingly with regard to that. And obviously what we've been presented with here is a sort of starting point, if you like. What we're actually asking officers to go away and do is bring back much more detailed options to us. Not just in terms of what's encapsulating the document, but other elements about that as well. And yeah, I think I speak for myself, but I think I speak for everyone in here. None of us would make a decision without having detailed investigation on any of these aspects, if not all of them. And with all of that, just because of the issue which has been most totemic to a lot of people, the recommendation that I was going to move additionally, seconded by Steve, is that in addition to recommendations A and B, is that a recommendation C, which is that with regard to the Mersey Ferries terminals, that we request officers to look at options around all three terminals, Peterhead, Woodside and Seacombe, that should include a future three-terminal service. Now I hope that really does reassure not just people in this room, but everyone in our city region, that we are serious at looking at the future of all of our terminals and getting the best possible outcome of that part of the ferry aspect, as well as the overall strategy and the overall service accordingly. So if that's seconded by Steve, then that's agreeable, then we can move forward.
I'll be seconded, Chair.
Thanks.
Thanks, Chair. Well, first of all, I welcome the 20-year strategy. Of course we've got to have a strategy. And I also welcome the tracks that we're making towards making it economical, because obviously you can't carry on running a business which is not economical. And I certainly welcome this notice of motion. I think it's got to be based around what we were providing for the future. We are talking about a growth area. We really should be looking at how we can grow those ferry patronage. Yes, it's had a history of patronage dropping off. We should be asking the questions about why it's dropping off, how we can put strategies in place to increase that, like we've done with the tunnels, like we've done with the trains. We should. I totally agree with what Steve said around that. So I welcome all that. I welcome the comments that's come over this matter. I also welcome your solution, which we will be supporting.
The situation, you know, it's not, you know, so that we have some kind of frequently answered questions up here, so they're informed of what's going on and what we're doing. And I think the media has a great deal to play in that role. And I think we need to ensure that the media of all different types are involved and know what the proper story is. And, you know, it's not that we're sitting here now making decisions, but for people in the offices, that green light. Look at what we should be doing as the best thing for the long-term future of the ferry service, Chair.
Yeah, thanks for that, Gordon. Now, we'll just sort of in response to that, so there was lots of detailed briefing that happened, not just in the media, but with a number of stakeholder groups beforehand. People like Friends of the Ferries, people like the Mersey Ferries Heritage Group and others. But obviously, we need to continue in that vein and do as much more as we can into the future. This is about a continuous process. One of the key parts about this kind of strategy is we'll be continuing to review. You know, we don't have that crystal ball and know what exactly things will be like in the 2030s. So that dialogue that we have with those groups and new groups and other groups that will emerge, and anyone who's interested, we need to make sure we continue that, we strengthen that, because actually we don't have a monopoly on wisdom. And I'm sure when we put all of our heads together across the city region, we'll come up with something even better than this really good starting point we've got now. So, with all of that in mind, if I can move the recommendations in paragraph number 2 of the report with the addition. next item is priorities for the future of Welsh infrastructure, and Hugh is going to be presenting this for us.
Thanks, Chair. I'll be very brief on this. Any questions, but as the report outlines, there's an opportunity for the Merseytravel Committee and part of the Combined Authority to submit evidence to the National Assembly for Wales. It's probably looking at the issue of Welsh rail infrastructure and the priority of the future rail, of future rail infrastructure in Wales. The terms of reference of that inquiry is set out in the appendix to your report, and the deadline for comments is next week on the 14th of January. We consider that it's prudent to submit a response for a number of reasons. The issue of cross-border travel by rail is particularly important for the Liverpool City region. We have these principles enshrined within the long-term rail strategy. We are long-standing members of the Mersey Alliance, for example, and the City region is also working very closely with Transport for the North on the whole issue of connectivity in an east-west direction. And it's interesting to note that the Welsh Assembly Government is now signed up to a memorandum of understanding with Transport for the North, just recognising the importance of those cross-border links. So as a result of that, that is why we are commending a response. The draft response to the questions is set out in section 4 of the response, section 4 of the committee report, I beg your pardon. We'll go through those in detail, but just to highlight a couple of salient points. We're noting that the whole issue of cross-boundary rail is a complicated one. Goes without saying, but it's an issue that we do need to flag and that we do need to address. For example, you can't look at Welsh rail infrastructure priorities in isolation. Many constraints, many capacity constraints are positioned in England. Many rail services in Wales, even north-south services, pass through large tracts of England. So you can't look at these issues of infrastructure in isolation. You have to look beyond the border. We pulled out in the response the example of the work we're doing to reinstate the Holborn Curve. We'll provide direct rail services from the Welsh area to Liverpool South Parkway to the airport. But there are some big infrastructure constraints in the Chester and Wrexham area that we are stating need to be addressed as a priority, because they have implications for England and for Wales alike. Equally, we're highlighting the importance of the Wrexham Bicester railway line, long-standing priority there to improve that service, given that it connects, amongst other things, three enterprise zones. There is a question posed by the Welsh Assembly Government as to whether or not the issue of rail infrastructure should be devolved to the Welsh Government as it is in Scotland. The issue is currently still the responsibility of the Westminster Parliament. It's not being fully devolved. On that issue, Wales officers don't feel it's appropriate for us to comment on an issue of devolution. It's for the people of Wales to decide how that should be taken forward, and for the Welsh Assembly Government to comment on that. The point we do make, though, is about the collaboration and the lessons that we've learned from bodies like Transport for the North, that what you need is deep, strong partnerships between cross-boundary areas. You put geographical boundaries to one side almost, and work for the common good, work to a common vision, and that's what we're commending. A final point to make is that we've worked quite closely with other bodies to ensure that our response is consistent. Transport for the North, Rail North, the Merseyrail Alliance, Cheshire West and Chester, to give you just four examples there. One issue that's emerged very, very recently, just from talking to other officers in other authorities, is that we could perhaps make a little more of the importance of the Welsh rail network, of the rail network in general, providing access to the airports at Liverpool and to Manchester. Mentioned the Holborn Curve that would provide direct access from North East Wales, or North Wales coast, to Liverpool Airport, which is effectively the nearest airport in relation to North Wales. So I'd just like to suggest, Chair, that in addition to the comments here, and in addition to any other comments that members might have, I just beef up the importance of Welsh rail infrastructure and infrastructure in general in supporting access to airports for people of Wales and vice versa. I haven't picked many queries.
No, that's correct, and personally I strongly endorse that. Thank you. I'll invite members if they've got any questions or comments on this item. links with Welsh Assembly Government already, strong links with parliamentary colleagues in Wales. The work we're doing for Transport for the North, where we're the appointed city region that's absolutely the kind of contact point for Welsh Government and Welsh partners working with, just continuing that accordingly. So I would strongly endorse everything that you've got in response, and obviously we'll find a suitable sentence of how we can highlight the importance of rail services from North Wales to Liverpool John Lennon Airport and other airports as well. So if we can agree those recommendations accordingly. Item 7 is a presentation that Gary's going to give us in terms of the smart ticketing approach. So, Gary, over to you.
So, as I'm sure colleagues are aware, we have reported regularly to this committee over nearly 2 years on the delivery of flawless cars to date. I'm sure you have looked forward to that each and every committee meeting. We now find ourselves at a natural point in the programme where we are looking to refresh, reshape and re-energise the programme, given that we have delivered Segway and Solo, both significant. And we're looking to now reshape and relaunch our programme for the forthcoming years. To do that, rather than present a formal report, I thought it would be worthwhile to share with you a more informal presentation, and if I can whistle through this as quickly as possible, since I've got the graveyard shift, and open to questions at the end. So just very quickly, I want to share with you a recap of where we've been. So, let's say December 2013, we rebranded into the Smart Ticketing Programme with Liz, who was delighted to accept the role of SRO, Responsible Officer, and myself as Programme Executive. We created three distinct projects within that. Project one was around refreshing and picking up the smart concessionary information. Project two was around transitional projects, which were the move of Safeway to the Walrus platform and indeed the existing solar product. And project three was really around starting to pick up our thinking of, if we were doing all this from scratch and we had plenty of time, plenty of money, how would we go about doing ticketing? So just to recap on those, project one is complete, smart data is being collected and was used in the financial arrangements with operators around concessionary travel. Project two has seen Safeway solar products go smart, with the paper equivalents being completely removed where there is a smart alternative available. And that's seen us with the water scheme having gone from absolutely no cards at all, open concessionary obviously, to the most active scheme outside of London, 800,000 tickets sold first 12 months, although, and obviously that has increased as we've launched more and more products in more and more areas. I think all that has been delivered with very little additional finance since